I was gonna just open up this hour by saying that the next time I may be out of town, I may have Maxine Bell actually host the show because she's been here a lot lately. You know the way, though.
And I am delighted that you would ask me back. To be asked back is a great treat.
Well,
Thank
you know,
you.
right off the top, I got a quick point I wanted to make. When Clark Kaufman was here yesterday, we were wrapping up, and he had talked a little bit about some of the challenges the state faces, and we talked about several issues that will be coming up. And it struck me that maybe not all of them, but a great many of them are related to this population growth we're seeing in Idaho. And a lot of news the last couple of weeks about the metropolitan area and Twin and Jerome counties, as well as the fastest growing state. And the Washington Post had a story yesterday. I don't know how I stumbled across this, but the writer said Idaho and a lot of its neighbors are growing rapidly. But the strange thing is, Wyoming had the least growth. And then the fellow said, I think I know the answer. He said, Wyoming is a one industry state. It's coal, it's boom or bust. 5 years ago, they were the fastest growing, now the slowest growing. And then he went on to conclude, he said, Idaho has a much more diversified economy. And he said, going back 100 years, he said, because when the mining industry dried up, people in Idaho had to come up with other things. Do
You
you
know
think
what they
this?
first did? They came in to grow the vegetables for the miners.
Right.
If you think about it, and you look at the area we're in, and we don't just milk the cows, we turn that milk into wonderful products, all kinds of different products. Yeah, well,
Jeez.
and yogurt and a powdered. So this value added, it's not just potato chips, it's
Right.
microchips also in Idaho, airplane parts, and the diversification that's been our salvation, and I'm grateful for that because that's taken some planning and some effort. We have people here who work at economic growth all the time, and then they go to CSI and work with them on getting the economic growth people who will work in it. And there's so much activity, and they realize that we can't just grow potatoes.
When I go for a drive some days, and just even on Pole Line Road, I see that great big hospital. I see I've got more choices to eat than I think I've ever had anywhere I've lived. And that's the positive, I guess, of growth is you get quicker access to medical care, and you have more choices in some of your dining experiences and shopping and the like. But obviously, I'm sure you hear from some of your constituents that, oh, this is getting out of hand.
Well, you know, we have added another Boise. Think about that. We've added something as large as Boise, and it's not all in Boise. So what I think about is they watch the state budget and they think it's growing out of hand, but you are so wise. This 45% growth that has come in since that big depression we had, we've grown the budget some, but we've stayed at 25% growth. And we've had in that budget, we've had 1.8% growth in the budget every year since that year. We were down 800 million. I think about that. I hope that all of my colleagues still have their rear view mirrors on. Because when you had to do what we had to do, closing schools, furloughing state workers, but the bright side of that was we started doing a lot of things more efficiently and better. And there's always a bright side with a down. You ran out of a good plan. You had no plan yet to stay with a fleet or stay with infrastructure. And now that's catching up with us and the roads. But we did do some things better. We did a zero-based budgeting exercise on all the agencies. Didn't save any money, but made the money go farther and did things more
I
efficiently.
got to ask you a question and I'll get it out of the way quickly because I know that a lot of people, I don't think they ask you this question because I think you intimidate them because you're a towering personality in state government.
I'm tall, is
But
all.
a lot of Republicans will say, gee, I don't know if Representative Bell is going to run for re-election. They don't apparently ask you because I think that again, there's a view that, you know, because of your towering personality, they're worried they're going to incur your wrath or something like that.
No. You know what I tell them? I tell them I'm in the middle of a term. I have a job to do. I don't want to be considered a lame duck person
Right.
who perhaps we don't have to work with her because she may not be here again. But then I look around at the kindness and the patience. They've allowed me to be there 29 years. I'm beginning to feel a little foolish about hanging on so long. But right now, I'm in the middle of a term, and that term doesn't end till next, just almost a year. So I'm going to go back with my spurs on and do the very best job I can. And then about the time we come to file, I'll look back then and see if I've done what I thought I needed to do.
A lot of the local folks don't want you to go because of that position with the Joint Finance and Appropriations Committee, because we lost your counterpart in the Senate from this region.
I hated that.
Right. And there's a belief that if you have somebody on the local level, they'll be looking out for local interests. Mm-hmm. And if you suddenly said, I've had enough of this, or I think it's time, that we would lose that because that would end up in somebody else's hands in a different region.
You know, I wish they wouldn't think that, because I've always felt that I was just as careful with CWI as I was with CSI, that I was just as fair with something in Eastern Idaho as I was with North Idaho. It's a great responsibility. There's 20 of us that take that money, and then we've got to portion it out and make sure everybody gets a shot at it. Now, Steve Miller from Fairfield, we consider that kind of part of the Magic Valley. He can get here if he's given a couple hours.
Over the hill.
Yeah. And he has been on JFAC, and he's become a very good, he carries the budget for the School for the Deaf and Blind, and he's my lead on CSI. And he knows how I feel about CSI. And my goodness, if he messed up, I have his phone number. But you have people like Clark and Lance, and they vote on that budget.
Mm-hmm.
They may not put it together, but they can open their mouths and say, whoa, what happened here? What are you doing? And so I think that I've always tried to be just as fair with all of it.
You mainly focused, I guess, with Steve last week on Joint Finance and those issues. You had some other things, though, too, that I know you wanted to address.
Well, my concern is the fact that this growth, this surplus, I'm not sure I like that word. It's coming in, and people are assuming we are maybe bringing too much money and there should be a tax cut. Maybe we are. Maybe there should be. You always look to see if your taxes are too high. But we are sitting in a situation, Bill, with things going on in Washington, D.C. And frankly, it's like the tip of an iceberg. Mm-hmm. I don't know what that will do to the conformity that we always do with our taxes. It may put us up. It may put us down. I don't know. We have a blue ribbon group right now trying to figure it out and see what that may do to the way we collect state taxes. So that's one thing to find. We still have a tremendous teacher shortage here. Apparently, our five-year plan is fine, but it hasn't accomplished people wanting to be in the schools.
As I read, the merit pay that was created really hasn't been used much.
Well, they're just now getting into that, but the other pay has helped some, I think. It's she wants $112 million this year, and 43 of that continues to go into the career ladder. And there are a lot of us that would drop on our swords before we would not keep that trust with those teachers. And so that's always first on my list. But there are so many things that don't show up. They're not interesting to anybody. We've got a system that runs the whole state. You can't cut a check without this system. And it's about, we need about 102 to 105 million, and it's got to be fixed. So I'm putting a system in place. They want a dedicated fund so they can start down that road, and they can assure the people that are doing the system that the money's there. So that's going to take 22, 23 million out of the revenue stream to put in that fund to make sure that Brandon Wolf can continue to do the job Brandon Wolf has been hired to do. And that's one thing. We've not addressed the infrastructure. The roads are not added. I don't know what Clark said yesterday, but
I had assumed that everything we did with Garvey last year settled it, but he said no.
Oh no, you have corridors. And the Garvey corridors are where there was a safety and a traffic. Now remember I just told you we've had just like another Boise. Well, a lot of those people are in Boise. And so that went on those corridors, and that money can only be used for those corridors. And it did, I will say this for Garvey, we were all nervous about it. We don't charge in this state. We run, you know, we don't run a credit line like that. It was a different animal. None of us really liked it. But over this past time, they have refinanced, and perhaps Clark told you, and come up with some extra money two or three times. So they are hitting those corridors that are in that original plan for the Garvey. It had to be that way.
Well, you know, yesterday there was a story out of Boise where they had to close the stretch of the interstate. We had an accident on the Perrine Bridge yesterday morning and it briefly shut down one of the lanes. I was sitting here thinking as I was reading the statement from ISP, by gosh, if that thing was ever closed for any long period of time, even just for a day, and I know people are looking at the talk of another bridge as being astronomical, but good golly, we've got so much growth here. We're going to have to start looking at other ways to move traffic around.
That's why you always want to plan. You always want a 5-year, a 10-year, and I believe your transportation people. I would bet you we have a fine transportation district manager here, and I would bet you that they're watching that type of thing. But at this point, they have a lot of bridges that you probably shouldn't even be driving on, let alone have an accident on.
They're not as obvious.
No, that's true. That's pretty obvious. And it's a beautiful bridge. And I don't know why people would want to jump off of it, but I'm grateful for it. If I had to go around by Hanson this morning, I guess I would have done so, but I'm grateful for that. But the state budget, I want you to think about the people now who run, who work in the government, and they're there for a reason. The governor has not given us his budget yet. We're waiting for it. And we're getting a piece at a time from the agencies. And it appears to be a 9% increase. I have to tell you, Bill, that ain't, I know better English, that is not going to happen.
Your students didn't get away with that.
No, they did not. They have 431 line items. I am going to have 20 people working very hard, sifting and winnowing those line items, and we are going to take a look at the maintenance part of the budgets, see where inflation is needed, take a look at the increase in the wages. You know, we do a lot of training of state police so they can work for Ada County.
Hold on to that thought. We've got to take a short break. We're coming up on 20 minutes after 9 o'clock. Our guest is State Representative Maxine Bell. It's 24 right now. Bill Colley with you as well on Top Story on News Radio 1310, KLIX, and NewsRadio1310.com. Our studio guest, Maxine Bell, Representative. She's joining us this morning. State Representative hails from Jerome, but covers also parts of Twin Falls County. We need to point out that people sometimes associate a legislator with a particular hometown, but the fact of the matter is the way we draw districts and they change periodically. Some people are representing multiple counties. Some people are representing just one county. But you have a pretty good sized district.
I love it. 46,000 people who are, I'm responsible to them to do the right thing. And some of them I never heard from. Some of them I don't know their faces. And I think about that. I never make a vote that I don't think. Well, you know, Murtaugh, there's Eden. And then at one time, I had Burley and Rupert. And people are patient, and they're kind. And if you're just still breathing up there and don't say anything really foolish, they're willing to do what they want to do or need to do here and let you go up there.
We talked one time, I know, a couple of years ago, and it was an issue on firearms. And and there were some complaints in the counties. And yet you said something that I thought was, it stayed with me to this day. You only had two people reach out to you. Now, you're the representative.
Right.
You have to follow along what people are telling you. And just two, people, they don't get involved often enough and take up their part of it, I think.
A couple who said to vote for, and I had I had about four times that many who said there really should be some training with it. And if you're a republic, this is not a democracy. This is a republic. That count matters.
Right.
And I thought, I always figure if there's one person I hear from, he or she speaks for 100. So I had a couple of hundred maybe who would have talked with them to the coffee shop and said, darn it, give us that right. And then I had this other, I think it was 17, 18 people, and add 100 to them. And they were concerned. And it, you know, the grateful thing that I'm grateful, there has not been an accident. There's not been anything that happened. And shortly after that, there was a professor in ISU who shot himself in his own foot. Right. And it could well have been the student he was bent over helping. So I look back on that and think, I would go the same way again. If that situation were with me, I wouldn't have changed. But thank goodness, it's working okay.
We've got a telephone caller looking to join us. And just I'll quickly point out the number, 208-736-0300. State Representative Maxine Bell in studio with us on Top Story on KLIX. Caller, you're up next.
Good morning. Hey, Maxine, this is Jeff Pearson.
Hey, how are you, Jeff?
I'm awesome.
Nice to hear your voice.
You too. I heard a rumor that you may be retiring. And I just—it may not be the appropriate time, but I just wanted to tell you how much I appreciated all that
Jeff,
you've done.
Thank you so much.
And tell a little story. You know, you were the person who first got me interested in reading. That was long before you were a legislator. And as a legislator, one time I remember that I had gotten really passionate about some issue, and I wrote a letter or email at the time to.
You did email me, yes.
And I used some words that were a little on the coarse side. And I really appreciate that Maxine was willing to say, you know, I don't think that's appropriate language. Maybe you should word that a little differently. And it was kind of a slap in the face, but it actually changed the way I started communicating.
Thank you,
so
Jeff.
So I really appreciate you.
Well, hey, Jeff, with you, it would have been a hug and a pat on the back. And I do remember that. And I have people, I emails are easy. You hit send so fast. Mm-hmm. And sometimes people say something they wouldn't. I have people wonder about my parentage. And I had the worst email I've had forever just not too long ago. And I wasn't sure exactly what the topic was. There was a letter that wound up in the newspaper that I had not signed. And I had never seen the letter nor had been asked to sign it.
It was going around, yeah.
Yeah, but you and I have remained friends just as we always were. You're a nice man.
Want to thank him for the call. We'll squeeze another caller in here. You can stick around in the next half hour anyway.
I can.
So we have a lot to talk about still. It's 24 right now. Caller, you're up next on Top Story.
Well, good morning, Representative Bell and Bill.
Good morning.
The legislature is going to be hammered again, top down, by the Conference of States pushing for an Idaho call for a constitutional convention.
I believe you're right. In fact,
And this is not a grassroots thing. They keep telling us that. But this thing needs, the legislature's got a lot more things to talk about and discuss than a call for a constitutional convention. It got voted down. It didn't even get to the House for a vote last year, 24-11 in the Senate. But believe me, they're spending millions of dollars to get their hands on the U.S. Constitution. And your position in leadership, this thing needs to be knocked in the head right away before it even gets the light of day. The other thing, your point you just made, so few people really get involved in the democratic process in our constitutional republic. Everybody says, well, you know, politics is dirty. I don't want to get involved in it. But believe me, that's the problem. We've got to have more people involved in letting you know and our elected people at all levels what their feelings are. Study the issues out and let you make those decisions then based on, you know, citizen input.
Can I want to thank him for the call. He referenced that constitutional convention, and I've had my own opinions on that. Mm-hmm. They've kind of gone back and forth.
And you do go back and forth on that. You can see both sides. I think the state sent a few people recently, Christy Perry was one, to a meeting. I was not asked to go, and there were a few people who went. So I would say that there's probably a nucleus of people who are really concerned about it and wanting to go that way that perhaps may do, but it's entirely up to leadership and the speaker as to what bills start and where they start. And it would have nothing to do with my appropriations committee. It would be something I would not see until it got on the floor, unless I had time to go to the hearing, if there were a hearing.
Where do you stand? Are you opposed at the moment? Or
Yeah, I am. But I listen and I think, well, something's, what happened just now? What happened with that tax break? What did they do to our debt again?
Yeah.
And then there are people who don't seem to think that debt is a problem. Well, it's a problem for a lot of people when you see people having to have help, a handout from the government because of debt. You know, you wonder. I wonder how long the Chinese will be there to fund us. So, but yes, and you're right. There, we always have many issues, but that'll be entirely up to the speaker and leadership whether that surfaces again this winter. And it's going to be an exciting. It's going to be a heavy duty, I think, because of all the people who are running for governor.
We've got more with Maxine Bell, our state representative, joining us this morning in studio. Coming up in the next half hour, we're at 25. It's 9:30 on Top Story on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. Our studio guest is state representative Maxine Bell, joining us in studio this morning on Top Story on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. It's 25 right now. Bill Colley with you as well on the program. Just a quick note, we have some more legislators joining us this week. Tomorrow morning, State Representative Lance Clow is in studio with us. And on Friday morning, we're going to be speaking with State Senator Jim Patrick. That'll be earlier in the show, just after 8 o'clock, and he may have to join us by telephone because he's going to be in meetings in Boise, which goes back to the fact that that legislative session lasts a few months, but the business goes on year-round.
That is correct. That you want to watch. You want to watch. I'm watching every day to see the elements that you never hear about with the budget. You know about the school. You know what they need because you watch those buses come and go, and you know a teacher, and you have a child maybe there. And it looks this year like we weren't on fire. And I can remember the year we had a $6 million fire bill, and then I remember the year we had a $60 million. So last year we chose to put a revolving 3-year average in place so we'd be covered, and it came out to $35 million. Those are the things you do when you have surplus, so-called surplus money. And I checked on that the other day, and he said, well, the bills come in for a long time. We either have $1 million left or we have $10 million left. So those are the reasons why you don't jump on a surplus and start deciding that perhaps you don't need it. Now, we've got this growth, and things look very good, but we're ticking up on Medicaid, and the prisons are filling. And this is exactly what happened in 2009. Exactly. And all of a sudden, perhaps you've heard that we're going to have to send prisoners out of state.
Yeah.
And it's much more expensive. I don't know what's with the county jails. We're trying to sort that out right now. Apparently some county jails don't want them and some do. And that's a work in progress right now. But those are the things I'm thinking about. I know I have a supplemental request when I go back. This is a course correction. That doesn't mean that you can come in between the budget and say, by the way, you didn't give me enough money. This means, by the way, something really broke. Well, it's mostly Medicaid. It's caseload that has gone up. And most of that is about $22 million there in Medicaid. So what's happening, Bill, with all this? Everybody's working and the jobs are better. And the growth in Idaho, and those are the things you watch and make sure you don't assume that, my gosh, you know, the money's pouring in. Let's do something different.
From the surface level, it seems, well, okay, the Democrats have told me they're not going to be chasing social issues. They didn't last year. They're not going to do it this year. They want to stick with just the nuts and bolts of government. So we're not going to have those issues coming to the forefront. We've at least addressed transportation to some degree last year, so it's not quite as critical. There's more emphasis on education.
Right.
But all of the mainstream media folks that I listen to say Obamacare is probably going to collapse next year. The Affordable Care Act, for those people who prefer that description. That means that a lot of this is definitely going to fall back on Boise. And that will be what you might call a crisis.
Right. These are people who are elderly and ill or blind. They're not working poor, though that's a different category. You help them with job training and with some child care. And that doesn't last very long. You know, after the welfare change some years ago, you cannot be on a welfare check for more than 2 years in your entire life. So we're not talking welfare. We're talking Medicaid, people who nobody else takes care of. And that has been flat. I've been using that money to put it into education. And all of a sudden, for some reason or other, that's changing. Well, attendant with that is the CHIP program for children whose parents work but are not able to put the children on some kind of health care. And this CHIP program has been a wonderful. We take some insurance money, and then now remember, Medicaid's a federal program. We administer it and go with it. The CHIP program, they reauthorized it, kinda. And we're not sure what, till the 19th of January, was that what they did before they left home, before they left town in Washington, D.C.? Should they not reauthorize the CHIP program for the children in Idaho, there will be a $29 million bill there. Those children need preventive care. The parents are working. They just simply cannot afford what they need.
And you've got to have all of that done. From January 19th until the end of your own session.
Yes, we do. We certainly do.
And so it's basically triage. I hate to say that. It may have to be that.
It is. So those are the things that when I look at the growth and I look at the income, we're in good shape. But that shape should never overshadow those things that we know, those pieces and parts that we know.
We've got to take a short break. We've got more with State Representative Maxine Bell on the way. It's 9:40. We're at 26. You're listening to Top Story with Bill Colley on News Radio 1310, KLIX, and NewsRadio1310.com. Our studio guest is State Representative Maxine Bell. Coming up on 9:42, we're at 27. A telephone number if you'd like to reach the representative before we wrap up here in about 15, 16 minutes is 208-736-0300. Bill Colley with you as well on Top Story. Again, that number, 208-736-0300. You've been sort of going line by line through a number of issues that you have today. And I should point out she's a far better note taker than I am. But you have a couple of pages still to go.
Well, I wrote down what's on my mind when I go back and what I'm concerned about. The governor's blueprint, obviously. And then I'm concerned about so many line items. People assuming, the agencies assuming that they can't do the people's business without that. And I know where I start my work. I start at the base and I look at what they need, maybe in inflation or maybe in wages. And then below the base is where you may add some things. And that's where I'm going to make sure I have a tremendous count. I have a tremendous a committee, tremendous, and great staff. And that's exactly where we're going to make sure that nothing looks like a 9% increase just because you suppose that there will be room left there for those who think that this is a good time to cut down our tax rates. There should always be room for that. But I should be able to know that and work with those folks and be prepared to work hand in glove, and I'm happy to do that.
Now, you had referenced what would happen if we lose some of that money coming from Washington and certain programs, and you also referenced the debt earlier. I had a friend call me from out of state the other day, and he was chatting with me about how the president and Interior Secretary Zinke are starting to pull away from this notion that the federal government needs to be heavily involved in Western land use. But if they do that, we're also likely going to see a lot of federal money go away.
Exactly.
And if we have a huge block of our state budget is financed by that, we're going to have to scramble quickly, number one, to find a solution or find ways to better generate revenue, maybe from some of those lands. Is there a plan in place, maybe, call it almost like the darkest day plan, where if something like that were to happen, that we'd be ready?
You know, I really think there is. Tom Schultz, I just heard he's leaving us, has been the best lands manager I have ever worked with. And you have to remember, I'm the dinosaur up there, so I do know a few of them. And I have a feeling we are already doing some cooperative work with federal lands and state lands, have been doing so. And we know that we want our land. We want the land back, but then we're responsible. Now, a lot of the fires this year, there was a fire up, I think, of Pine, Idaho last year. Do you remember that? Mm-hmm. And it was $400 or $500 million. It was on federal land. So had it been ours, there you see. So maybe the trade-off there for having more responsibility and having more of our own land, maybe that trade-off is worth it. But yes, I would hope that there's some work going on in that department. He's done a wonderful job getting money back for the schools from the land that he's responsible for selling. You know, we just sold some buildings off. And the timber money has been coming in very well, and so that's been a help with the school budgets, which is his constitutional charge.
We have another caller looking to join us. State Representative Maxine Bell is on the air with us. It's 9:45 on Top Story on KLIX. And caller, you're up next.
Just a quick question. I'll listen to answer off the air. Has anyone ever considered not giving money to this federal government through their fraudulent tax system so that you have to beg for it back from them? Thank you.
Well, I don't know if anyone I know considered that. I think we're all, it's called being law-abiding. As long as it's the law, you live by the rule of law. And darn it, you might be really happy to get some of our money back when you come to the roads. When you pay that gas tax, we get more back than we send there. You might remember that if that makes you feel a little better.
And we want to point out the roads so far this winter look a lot better than they did last year.
Oh, boy, do they ever. And, you know, last year we were happy to find about January came in about $50 million more than what we thought, if you remember, Bill. And we were able to go to the speaker and the pro tem and put a plan together. And that went out to the counties for that all that damage. It was terrible damage in spots.
It's nice to have that little unexpected.
It is.
In the past, you've talked a little bit about surpluses. And yep. I know there's always a debate. Do you give a surplus back or do you hold that in a rainy day fund? The rainy day fund was what got us through the crisis 10 years ago.
Thank you for bringing that up. We finally had to take the Obama money that came out, and finally that was our last thing that we did. But yes, and we emptied every coffer we had. Well, at this point, we would like Dean Cameron and I put a bill in place that said, hey, we are at 5% rainy day. Whoa, you know, tithing is 10%. We better take a look at 10. We're at about 8% back in the. So what you do here, Bill, you make sure that you're not saving people that people themselves could save. So save the what is reasonable to cover the cost of keeping the prisons closed and the schools open, and then make sure you're not taking it out of people's pockets who could do their own saving and buy their own children's shoes and pencils. So it's kind of a balance.
I read the other day where Harvard University has an endowment of nearly $40 billion. So if tomorrow they had no more money coming in from student tuition or government or anybody else in any way, they could operate for years on end. We don't obviously have anything of that. We're talking just a few $100 million.
Right. In fact, we have a savings account for the schools. Every year we true up And all of these children who have moved here with their parents suddenly were not on the rolls to begin with. And last year, at the 1st of July, we trued up with $20 million. Well, that savings account has no revenue stream. That's a good place to park some money because we can't tell. We get that count, and they move, and it keeps changing.
There was a figure that floated around on social media a couple of weeks ago, even among some legislators and some candidates, that says that the state is spending $200 to $300 million a year. It's an estimated burden, obviously, because of people who aren't here legally. Mm-hmm. Is that true, or is that perhaps just an exaggeration?
It's nothing I have heard of in my budget work. So
nobody actually would have a line though that says
no,
for programs for people here illegally.
No, we don't really have that line.
That's a number that I don't really know that anyone has a grasp of what that would be.
I'm not sure they do, but we can look into that. I'll look into that and call you back. I do have one light item I know. Every year when I set the budget, I don't leave the table bare. I leave $50 or $60 million on the table just in case. It's just in case that's one-time funding, mm-hmm. and I may need it. So when you're looking at that surplus, be sure and subtract the 60 that I left just in case.
We're going to see, we talked earlier, for people who are just tuning in, mm-hmm. The representative is not making any announcements about another term. She's going to think about it for a while. I know that a caller even referenced that earlier mm-hmm. as well. But we have a governor who's going to be stepping down. Uh-huh. Does that impact any of the decisions made this year, or is that just normal enough that we can get through it?
It should not. This is his last year. That budget that comes from him should be as thoughtful as any he's done, and we should treat it as such. So we should watch for him, same as I. I want people to be sorry I left. And when he leaves, I'm sure he wants the same thing. But you bring up a good point, boy. It's once that primary gets going and once all that activity starts in this state, I look at what those other people have talked about cutting, and I think, well, it's always a good idea to see where you can clean up my line items and clean up some places I thought were important.
What?
But don't you close CSI and don't you think for 1 minute that we've been just pouring money on places, because that isn't the way it's worked.
We have one candidate who says he can cut $100 million right off the top, and I was at a social event, and I was talking with a publisher of another media entity in town, uh-huh. and I said, well, I guess we'll stop pencils and erasers, because do we have $100 million we could cut?
He thought, he has tried to talk to me several times, and he felt it was the way we do our health care. Health care has been an issue for us, but some experts have looked at that and figured that we were doing the very best we could with what our state employees cost for health care. That's an issue we have with the schools. We've been trying to work in a way to help them with more reasonable ways to give good health care to their teachers and not take that out of their discretionary funds that turn the lights on and turn the heat on. So there's always that. Health care is an issue. It will be an issue. But the others are cutting too. I think Little says he is going to cut, but he's going to do it over more time. Now, Brad Little knows what we've been doing, and I would be happy to sit down with him and say, Brad, you've been a good lieutenant governor. Tell me where you think I could start right now. Tell me what you think. But talking to Tommy, it's all about cutting health care. And once you get 64% of your budget into education and another 19 into health, I say health and welfare, but welfare is a very small part of it, let's say Medicaid, and another 10 or 11% into keeping people safe, into prisons, and putting a few state police on the road, what do you think that leaves? What do you think that leaves to really trim? The Department of Ag, hardly any money there. Department of Commerce, that money all goes out to keep the economy booming. So I can't quite figure out where. And of course, Congressman Labrador said he'll cut $900 million, and they, I wish them success, but you can't strip to bare bones and have core responsibilities taken care of.
I guess you could close down state government and just have the counties handle their own business.
You could do, I suppose.
Subsidiarity, I think, is how that's referred to.
Is that right?
Yeah. We'd have some vast differences, though, because if you live in Camas County, there's no real tax base.
No, not at all.
Versus if you live in Ada or Canyon County, you'd have considerably more.
And you talked about Challis. There's no tax base there. 92% of the land there is federal.
Got about 3 minutes to go. We didn't get to everything on your list.
I think we did. I've been kind of looking to see what I really hope that people would know when I start setting that budget, what I'm looking at and what my concerns are, and watch the process and hope and know that we're striving to make sure that if there's a tax break, a reasonable tax break, it's there. And if there's money to still be put in savings, it will be there. And the schools will not be harmed, nor anybody who's blind and elderly.
I had a conversation last year, Easter weekend, with Representative Hartken. Mm-hmm. And it was at the time the battle was going on the grocery tax. And he said, oh, look, it'll come up next year. It'll just come up earlier. The thing is, the more I look at it, I realize, okay, if you eliminate it, you are not necessarily cutting spending. So it's basically, you know, you mm-hmm. move one thing and you got to move it. I had an astronomer friend who said it's a little bit like taking the blanket. You pull it up over your head, but your feet then are cold. So the notion is you could eliminate it, but if you don't have a place to cut spending, you have to raise it somewhere else. How are you going to vote on that?
If it comes up, I will vote against it again, because you start playing with a tax system. Let's take a look at the whole system. Let's not do a cut. Let's do a look and see where we can trim. I like the idea of trimming the rates.
Mm-hmm.
I think 6% is a little high. That troubles me somewhat. And you have to know that you and I, when we put our taxes in, we will get that money back for the food tax that we paid, the tax on food. It will come back to us, and that money's in the budget. And should you not pay any federal state taxes, you can still apply for that food tax back.
I would think that most people, though, and Clark Kaufman talked about this yesterday, I brought it up, maybe you tax the Doritos, but you don't tax the green peppers.
Mm-hmm.
Because the green peppers, we know, are good for people. The Doritos is a choice you can make to take or to leave it. And most people, I think, are not necessarily opposed to alcohol or tobacco taxes because, again, you know, this is a product you can live without.
Mm-hmm. We don't seem to raise any taxes on those products.
Yeah, maybe people aren't using them as much.
That's right. There's so few people using them. That was a difficult. The way that came around the back door, the way that came around the last minute, the way they were working on other things, it just didn't seem reasonable. And you know what? It would have been me playing games. It was not going anyplace. I knew that. So do I want to look like a pretty lady who does it? No, I did what I felt was right on that. And we'll see what that looks like this year.
We want to thank you for coming by, and we should note, too, as well, a lot of these issues, it's always nice to tell people you're going to save them money and cut the budget and all, but you've got to have the answer what you do afterward.
Exactly. And usually, maybe the place I cut for one person hurt another person. You don't want to do that.
Well, we wish you luck.
We'll be
talking to you again, I hope, during session.
Thank you. I'd like that.
All right, super. We want to thank Representative Maxine Bell for joining us in studio today. Tomorrow, it'll be State Representative Lance Clow. We want to point out the Rush Limbaugh program is coming up following the news at 10 o'clock from Fox. And God willing, at the Creektown Rise, I'll be back here tomorrow morning between 8 and 10 o'clock.